Okay, so welcome back to the session after lunch. So the speaker now is Professor K. Srinivas. He's a faculty member here, professor of mathematics here in the Institute of Mathematical Sciences. He is very interested in number theory and cryptography. Those are his mathematical research interests. That apart, he is also very involved in, you know, such fora, talking to school children and so on. He's been an active member of these interactive mathematics camps, which have been, you know, been running in Orissa over many years. So he's very interested in talking to school children and so on. So today he's going to talk about heuristics.
So good afternoon, everyone. I hope you had a good lunch. Yeah? All of you had lunch, right? Okay. So we can start the session. So, see, one of the problems is when you encounter a problem, how to solve it, right? That's the first problem. So there should be some ways, okay, the techniques or the tactics or the strategies that are adapted to solve a problem is what is called heuristics, okay? It's a strategy. First you think of some plausible solution and then you rigorously prove that in fact that is the solution. So these are, they come under the name of heuristics. So there are various ways of proving something. In your books, one proof is given or one solution is given, and invariably you are told that this is the solution, or you get the idea that this is the only way of solving the things. In fact, even parents, when they teach their children, they say that no, what we have learned in school, that is the only solution, and only if you do like that you will get marks, otherwise not. So that's a myth, okay? One should look at the problem with open mind. So I would like to write down some popular ideas that exist in mathematics. So the basic ideas. To solve a problem. Okay, first thing is, which you might have seen in the morning session, to search for a pattern. Okay, when you are given a problem, maybe there is a pattern that will tell you how to solve it, okay? Draw a figure. Sometimes drawing a figure makes the concepts very clear and gives an idea how to solve the problem. Okay, 1, 2, 3, I will write one. Okay, formulate an equivalent problem. Okay? In Professor Arindamma's talk, you have seen there is a bijection. Okay? And it's easy to count the number of elements in the other set. Okay? So it's nice to, if you can formulate an equivalent problem and you can solve the original problem gets solved. Okay? Many times, choosing an effective notation, choose hope all of you can see what I'm writing. It's visible, right? And often, if there is a symmetry, then exploit it. Divide into cases. divide the problem into small, small cases and solve it. Work backwards. When you are not able to solve a problem, try to see from backwards whether you can, you know, that gives an idea. Argue by contradiction. Okay? We will see some of these things, how these things are applied. Pursue parity. Consider extreme cases. Generalize. So there are, you know, these are the ideas, some of the ideas, you know, that are commonly employed. Okay? But there is a word of caution: whenever there is a problem, don't look at it with some fixated, you know, heuristic. You should look at the problem with open mind. Generalize. Consider extreme cases. Pursue parity. Argue by contradiction. Okay? Extreme? Pursue. Oh, okay. Sorry. Thanks. Okay, pursue parity. Okay? So, we are not going to illustrate all these things. We will take an example, okay, which you have done it in the morning class also, and see various, you know, beautiful ideas that come. See, one of the problems that we hear from our friends from IIT, most of you perhaps, you know, will be trying for IITs and things like that, right? Yes? Yes or no? It's an interactive camp, okay? It's not a monologue, so you have to respond. So, the general result, you know, people, they score very high marks in the entrance exams, JEE. And then they enter into IIT, and it has been observed that in the first year exams in IIT, there is a large percentage of failures. Okay? So there is a word of caution that now whatever you are studying, try to look at the theory behind it. Mathematics is not just a bunch of formulas. Just if you wrote the formulas and get a result, that's not mathematics, right? If you understand it, if you enjoy, then you will never fail. Okay? Yes? Yes or no?
Yes.
Are you getting convinced? Okay. So in the morning you have seen, let's look at the example. Let's write down the question. Prove that a set of n different elements has exactly 2 to the power n different subsets. Okay? This is a problem that you have seen, right? And this problem comes quite often, and almost all interviews they ask you this question. Okay? But when you see it for the first time, it's not so clear how to proceed. Okay, another thing, there are videos of our math science lectures, outreach programs, and this topic has also been discussed by Professor Vishwanath in last month's program for teachers. Okay, so you can also have a look at that video. So, however, suppose we restate the problem. So restate it as question. How many subsets can be formed from a set with set of n objects? Okay, same question, but just wrote in a slightly different way. Okay, or same question, prove or disprove a set of n elements has 2 to the power n subsets. Okay, again the same question. Okay, but here there is a suggestion. Okay, there is some suggestion how to proceed. How many subsets can be formed from a set of n objects, or prove or disprove that a set of n elements has 2 to the power n subsets. Maybe you can take few cases, okay, n is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3, 4 and all. See whether it is true or not, and if it is true, then try to generalize it. Use some method to prove it, that what you think right is in fact right. Okay, so let's do that. Okay, so let us take a set with n is equal to 0, 1, 2, 3 elements and see whether there is some pattern, there is some symmetry. Okay, so write down n and then elements of S and then subsets of S and then number of subsets of S. So when n is equal to 0, how many elements are there in the set S? 1. What is that? 5. Okay, there is none and this is 5. Okay, therefore number of subsets is 1. This is the set. Okay, when there is one element, let's say x1 is one element in S, and the number of subsets, what is that? Give me the answer. 5 and x1. 5 and x1. So there are 2. When n is equal to 2, let's say x1, x2, you have 5, x1, x2, x1, x2. So there are 4. N is equal to 3, x1, x2, x3, you have 5, x1, x2, x1, x2, right? and then you have x3, x1, x3, then x2, x3, then x1, x2, x3. So there are 8. Okay. So this table, of course, verifies the assertion. Can you see a little more than that? Because we want to now take a set with n elements, okay, and argue. Okay. How did we get from this to this? When case n is equal to 1 to 2, we have taken all the subsets of this one and augmented each subset with x2. Do you see that? X2 to x3, when n is equal to 2 to 3, when we come, these are all the subsets of the previous set. And then we have augmented each subset with the element x3. So there is some, you know, some pattern that you can see. Is it clear? All of you in the balcony? Good. Therefore, therefore, if you take n is equal to 4, then how to argue it here? You take all the subsets of when n is equal to 3, S3. Okay. So therefore, there are 8 subsets when n is equal to 3, and with each subset you are augmenting one more element. So plus 8, 16, which is 2 to the power 4. Okay. And then you can use induction now to in fact verify, to prove the result. So this is an observation, this is a heuristic. Okay? What you are observing here, what you are augmenting, this is what you are getting. Okay? Therefore, if you take a set of with n elements, you will get 2 to the power n as the number of subsets. This is one heuristic. Let's look at it again. Okay. Let's write an number of subsets with n elements. Okay, number of different subsets with n different elements. Okay, here this is implied. And take the set S, okay, to be a set with n plus 1 elements. Okay, let's say x1, x2, xn, and then there is another element x. Okay, we want to count how many subsets are there. We want to answer this question. Okay. What is the cardinality of the power set? Okay. So what is the an, number of subsets with n elements? Okay. Okay. If you look at here, these are all the subsets without x3. These are all the subsets with x3 in it. Okay, if you do it for 4 also, you same get the same observation. Okay, this suggests that, you know, the number of subsets without x in it, x is just an element, okay, and the number of subsets with x in it are in 1 to 1 bijection. these are all the subsets without X3 in it. And you have augmented, okay? These are all the subsets with X3 in it. And there is a one-to-one correspondence. Okay? So there is a one-to-one correspondence between, so one-to-one correspondence between the subsets T and T union X, where what is T? T are the subsets without X in it. So T is where T's are subsets of the set S minus X. Okay? Therefore, what is A n plus 1? What will be A n plus 1? (2an). Okay? An union an, right? 2an. Okay? What is A0? 1. So here is a recurrence relation, right? And one can solve it. How to solve this recurring relation? So we wanted an, okay? This is the question. So this is 2 times an minus 1. This is 2 square times an minus 2. 2 to the power n times a0. Right? Simple observations. Okay? Let's do a little more. Let's take a set S with 3 elements and draw a tree. So what is the tree? A bar. With B bar, C bar, with A bar, with B, B bar, so we are trying to identify the subsets of S with the branches of a tree, okay? Where, so this branch A, B, C indicates the sets A, B, C. This bar means that element is not there in the subset, okay? So what is this branch will indicate which subset? A, comma, B. So this will indicate A comma B, and this one A, B is not there, C, this is only A. This one, A is not there, B, C. Only B. At this one, C. And last one is 5. Have you got all the subsets? Okay. Now, in general, what does this suggest? So let's observe it. What is happening? So every time a new element is added, the number of branches doubles. Okay. So here, when A is there, there are 2. When B is added, the number of branches 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. Here, when C, so there are 3 stages, right? In each stage, when you go to the next stage, the number of branches simply doubles. Okay? And the number of branches is nothing but the number of subsets. So for a 3 element set, there is 2 cross 2 cross 3. And therefore, for an n element subset, there will be 2 to the power n. Okay? Is it convincing? Yes or no? All of you? Okay. Okay. This is yet another way. Okay, there are various ways. Let's see. Okay, let's take S to be A, B, C, D and write down the subsets of this in the increasing order of their numbers. Okay? So here number of elements, and then number of subsets. So when number of elements is 0, you just have phi, and that means you have only 1. When the number of elements is 1, so this is one element subsets. Okay? One element subsets A, B, C, D. So this is A. D. So there are 4 subsets. Now, 2. Okay? All 2 element subsets. So A, B, A, C, A, D, let me write it down. And then B, C, B, D, C, D. How many are there? 6. 3 element subsets. Tell me. A, B, C. A, B, D. A, C, D. And then B, C, D. Okay, 4 of them. And finally, 4 element subset, 1 only. A, B, C, D. 1. Okay, this is the observation. Now we want to go for an n element subset. N element set. So take S and we want to count the number of subsets. Can you see something here? See, this is the total number of subsets, right? 1 plus 4 plus 6 plus 4 plus 1. What is this counting? The number of subsets with 0 elements. This counts the number of elements with 1 element. Out of how many? 4. And this counts the number of subsets with 2 elements. Number of, therefore, in general, for if S has n elements, what can you say about the number of subsets of S? So you sum all the things, right? That means you take any k. This is the number of ways in which you can choose a k element subset out of a n. So k objects can be chosen, you have seen in the morning, out of n objects. This is the number of ways. Now k varies from 0 to n. What is this quantity? 2 power n. How? So this is right, 2 to the power n. Because the binomial theorem says this is equal to summation this is x power k y power n minus k with some coefficients n c k. Now put x is equal to 1, y is equal to 1, you get that. Okay, fine. Finally, now I think I can erase this one. So let us have one more, you know, systematic way of looking at these things. Namely, with each subset we will write a number. So this is subsets. So for example, phi, and this is our triple. So we are looking at a three element subset. X1, X2. This is our set and we want to enumerate all the subsets of this. Okay. So phi we will write with 0, 0, 0. Okay. And x3 we will index it. So x3 will be 1 in the third place. So this is 0, 0, 1. Okay. X2, the subset X2, 0, 1, 0. X2, X3, 0, 1, 0. X1, what will come next? X1? And then x1, x2. This is 1, comma 1, comma 0. And finally, x1, x2, x3. 1, comma 1, comma 1. Okay. Now, we can write them as binary numbers, right? 0, 0, 0. Right? So this is 0, 1, 2, and so on forth. So decimal number. Two, four, five, six, seven. The last one is 7. Okay. Now, what will happen for an n element set? So what is the observation here? Each subset of S is identified with a string of zeros and ones. Right? Is it all right? Each subset of this, any subset, take any subset, there corresponds to one number here. Conversely, every 3-bit string is associated to one subset of this S. So there is a bijection between the subsets and the strings A, B, C, where A is 0, 1, B is 0, 1, C is 0, 1. A can be 0, 1, B can be 0, 1, C can be 0, 1. So there is a 1-to-1 correspondence between these subsets and the strings of length 3, binary strings of length 3. Therefore, it's enough to count how many possibilities are there. And they are less than 2 to the power 3, because this is the largest number, right? Which means there are 8 starting with 0, right? Therefore, if you take a set S which has n elements, xn, each subset of this, so now we are going to generalize this one, right? With an n set. Each subset of this is associated with a string of these numbers, where what are the AIs? They are either 0 or 1. So AI is equal to 1. So a subset A is associated. So with every subset A of S, we associate a string of length n. Now, what are AIs? AI is 1 if AI is in this, otherwise 0. Is it all right? Just look at this example. So the examples will give you clarification, you know, to understand these things. So if AI is in A, 0, otherwise. Okay? And the number of such strings are in 1-to-1 correspondence with all non-negative numbers less than 2 to the power n. Okay? So there is a 1-to-1 correspondence between subsets of S and binary n tuples So each n-tuple corresponds to a subset. And these are, how many of them are there? The number of such tuples. Conversely, if you take any number which is less than 2 to the power n, that corresponds to one subset. And therefore, the number of subsets is equal to 2 to the power n. Okay? So what I'm trying to illustrate is there's whole lot of things to look at. A problem can be seen in several ways. Okay? Another, let's change the topic. We will consider one of the oldest problems in number theory. How many primes are there? So many? How many? Infinite. How do you know? N square. What is n? Okay. P is the largest prime, let's say. So you're looking at P square plus 1. So P square plus 1 is either a prime or a composite number. No, so there is some problem there. Okay, let's see. So it was Euclid p factorial will do. P square will not work. Okay, so there are again there are infinitely many primes. Okay, so again the problem is how to start. Okay, where to start? You can again say that the sequence of primes do not end or doesn't end, right? So how Euclid did was, it is still one of the most elegant things. So take a set of finite, let's say 2, 3, 5, 6. Take any finite set of primes, okay? And consider the number 2 into 3 into 5 into P plus 1. So call this number as N, okay? Take all the primes, finite set of primes, add 1 to it, consider this number. There are two possibilities, either it is composite or prime. So if it is prime, certainly n is bigger than p. If n were prime, n will certainly be bigger than p, therefore n doesn't belong to, there is a prime which doesn't belong to this set, right? Because we have taken these many primes, we have got one more prime, another prime, which is not in this side. If n is composite, so there is some, one fact that we are going to use it, every number is divisible by a prime. Right? Are you okay with this? Every number, so this requires a proof, it's not so trivial. Okay, so exercise you must convince yourself every number, every integer has a prime divisor. Maybe itself. 7 has a prime divisor, 7 itself. Okay? So, with that, so this number has a prime divisor. So, Q divides this number. Can Q be any element in this set? Can Q be equal to any prime in this set? Q is a prime. Okay? If Q were equal to any of these primes, Q will divide the product of this. So, Q will divide 2 into 3 into 5 into P, because Q is sitting somewhere. Therefore, Q will divide N minus 2 into 3 into 5 into P. Because if Q divides N and Q divides this, it will divide the difference. But the difference is 1. But we have assumed that Q is a prime. So it is not possible. Therefore, Q doesn't belong to this set. So Q is another prime which is not in this set. So what it says is that you start with any finite set of primes. It says that any finite set of primes cannot contain all the primes. Because whenever you have a finite set of primes, you can always exhibit another prime which is not in this set. Okay? That shows that there are infinitely many primes. Okay? But this is not the only way of proving this thing. Okay? Have you heard of Fermat? Fermat's last theorem? So, the Fermat, what he did was, around 1650, he looked at the numbers of the form Fn. Okay? See, it's around 1650. Okay? And he considered this sequence of numbers. So F0 is 3, F1 is 5, F2 is 17, F3 is 257, F4 is 65537. Okay? This is a prime. This is a prime. This is a prime. This is a prime. Are you convinced? How do you know this is a prime? 257. Yeah? How to check? See, you are given a number, right? You are given a number, this is not very large number, but not so small that you keep on dividing by all the numbers less than this, right? Now, when you say 7 is this, we know that these are primes. 17 is prime because you divide it by 3, 5, 7 and all these things, it's not divisible. Therefore, how are composite numbers defined? N is a composite number if N can be written as A times B with AB. So N is composite right? This is the definition of composite number. It has non-trivial factors, not one and not itself. Okay? Now, can A, so A and B are both less than M. Okay? Question is, can A and B be both bigger than square root of N? Can they both be bigger than square root of N? No. Why? If both are bigger than square root of N, their product will be bigger than N. So that tells that one of them must be less than or equal to square root of N. Okay? This implies either A or B must be less than or equal to square root of N. So if N is composite, it will have a prime factor, it will have a divisor, it will have a factor which is less than the square root of the number. In particular, it will have a prime factor less than square root of N. So 257, you need not check whether it is divisible by all primes up to 257. It is enough if you check with all primes. So what are all the primes less than 257? Square root of 257? How many are there? Yes? NH? Okay. So, tell me all the primes less than square root of 257, please. 2? Ah. 17. That's all. 17 will come? No. So, therefore, now you can test, you know, the divisibility by these primes. If none of these primes, they divide this number, then you know that this is prime, right? So it's easy. But what about F4? What about F4? That's a big number. Okay? So again, it requires to collect all the primes up to square root of F4, check the divisibility by each prime. If none of them divides, then this number is prime. So Fermat did all this up to F4, and F5, when he came to F5, which is 4, 2, 9, 4, 9, 6, 7, 2, 9, 7, F5, 2 to the power 32 plus 1, it's a huge number. Okay? He thought it will be a prime. And then he said that all numbers of the form, they're primes. They're called Fermat primes. But it was Euler, 100 years later, around 17, who showed that in fact F5 is equal to 641 times 6700417. In particular, 641 divides F5, so it's not prime. Okay, fine. So what an interesting property of the Fermat numbers is, take any two Fermat numbers, Fn and Fm. N is not equal to m. So there is no common factor. That means the GCD of any two distinct Fermat numbers is 1. We'll show this. Okay, before that, let's look at this one. So let's look at F1. Maybe F0, Fn minus 1. Take all the Fermat numbers up to n minus 1. You multiply them. This happened to be Fn minus 2. We can use induction. For n is equal to 1, so this is nothing but product of Fk maybe 1, 2. So I would like to take, yeah. Okay. So when n is equal to 1, when n is equal to 1, that means you have only F0 here. And what is F0? What is F0? 3. And what is Fn minus 2? F0 minus 2, F1 minus 2, when n is equal to 1, F1 minus 2, F1 is 5, minus 2, 3. So this formula agrees when n is equal to 1. All of you know induction hypothesis, right? N is equal to 1, n is equal to 1 means F0 you get, right? On the left hand side you get F0. On the right hand side, you get F1 minus 2. Now, assume that it is true for n, prove it for n plus 1. So, so F, what is the product F0, F1 up to Fn? This is nothing but F0, F1 up to Fn minus 1 times Fn, right? And what is by induction hypothesis, what is this one? This is Fn minus 2. So this is Fn minus 2. And this is Fn. What is Fn minus 2? 2 to the power n plus 1 minus 2, and this is this is 2 to the power n minus 1 and 2 to the power n plus 1. What is the product? 2 to the power, this is n plus 1, you get minus 1, which is 2 to the power n plus 1 plus 1 minus 2, which is F n plus 1. So by induction hypothesis, the statement is true for every n. Okay? Fine. So once you have this, so look at this. Now take any F of m and F of n, where m is less than n. Let d divides F of m d divides f of n. D divides f of m means d divides the left hand side, because m is less than n. So f of m occurs somewhere here, and d divides f of n means d divides this number. So d divides this and d divides this number would mean d divides. Are you paying attention or not? Yeah. D divides f of m. M is a number less than n. Okay. Therefore, f of m occurs somewhere here, right? So d divides the left hand side, and also d divides f of n. Therefore, d will divide 2, because d divides this and d divides this would mean d divides 2. Therefore, what can you say about d? It can be 1 or 2. Can it be equal to 2? No. Why? All these numbers are odd. They can't have 2 as a divisor. Therefore, d has to be 1. Therefore, all the there is no common divisor. Therefore, the GCD is 1. Okay? That means, you take any sequence f1, f2, f3. The infinite sequence, right? No two of them have any common factor. Every number has a prime divisor. Therefore, there are infinitely many primes. Right? Is it all right? So this is the elegancy of mathematics, mathematical proofs, mathematical theories, theorems, and all these things. Last, I have some time, few minutes? 2 minutes, okay. You know this name of the function? So what does it do? It counts all the numbers less than n and coprime to n. Okay? In particular, phi of any prime p. How many numbers are there which are less than p and relatively prime to p? So are you understanding? How many numbers are there? 1, 2, 3. Up to p. In this set, how many doesn't have any common factor with p? How many are relatively prime to p? So this number doesn't have any common factor with p. 2 doesn't have any common factor. Up to p minus 1, none of them have any common factor with p. Therefore, phi of p is p minus 1. What is phi of p square? It is not p square minus 1. You are looking at 1, 2, 3, of course, up to p square. But which are the numbers which are not coprime to p square? There is a p here, and then there may be 2p, there may be 3p, and this is p times p. So you remove p of them. And then you get all the numbers which are coprime. So total numbers are p square, and remove p of them. Okay? In general, phi of pq is phi of p, phi of q. More generally, phi of mn, phi of m, phi of n, whenever there is no common factor between m and n. Okay. Now, final 1 minute more. So look at this number. N is 2, 3, 5. So suppose P is the largest prime. Okay. Again, we are looking at the problem infinitely many prime. P is the largest prime. Look at 1, 2, 3 up to P. Yeah, multiply all the primes. Call this number as N. Okay? You have taken all the primes, multiplied them, formed a number N. What is phi of N? See, phi of N by this definition, phi of 2, phi of 3, up to phi of P. So this is okay. Phi of 2 is 1. Phi of 3 is 2. So this is at least 1. Right? But what does phi count? Number of integers co-prime to n. So how many numbers are there which are co-prime to n? In the set 1, 2, 3 up to this n. In this set where n is this number. Is 2 co-prime to n? Is 3 co-prime to n? Is 5? Is 4? 6? 7? P? None of the numbers are co-prime to n except for 1. So this is by using the definition, because P is the largest prime we have assumed. Okay, that is the contradiction. P is the largest prime. You have looked at this number. Okay, by definition of Euler quotient, phi of n is a number which is bigger than 1. However, using the same definition, which counts the number of elements which are co-prime to n, there can't be any number other than 1, right? Because all the primes are there less than n. Okay, so none of these numbers can be co-prime. Therefore, it is 1. Therefore, there is a contradiction. This shows that the number of primes cannot be finite. Okay? So I think I will stop it and hope you have got some ideas about how to initiate, when you are looking at a problem, how to think about it. So please don't rote the formulas. Just try to enjoy, just to think about it a little bit more. Thank you.